All right, so today we're going deep on something a listener specifically requested.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, practical advice for recovering from emergency gallbladder surgery. It's not really something you can plan for, you know?
Right.
But knowing what to expect can make a huge difference.
Absolutely.
Especially when it feels like things are moving so fast.
Yeah, definitely.
And remember, we're working with the listener source material for this deep dive.
So it's really tailored.
Exactly. So let's start with the basics.
Okay.
What exactly does the gallbladder do?
So basically, it's this little pouch that sits under your liver.
Okay.
And it stores bile, which is this fluid that your liver makes to help break down fats.
So it's part of the whole digestive system.
Right.
So then what are gallstones?
Gallstones are like these little hardened deposits that can form in your gallbladder.
And those are what usually cause problems.
Yeah. A lot of times they just kind of hang out and don't cause any trouble. But okay. Sometimes they can block the bile duct.
And that's when things get serious.
Yeah, exactly.
So what happens then?
Well, when that happens, you get like intense pain and inflammation, maybe even an infection.
And that's when you need emergency surgery.
Right. That's often when a cholecystectomy is necessary.
Which is
the surgical removal of the gallbladder.
Okay. So there are a couple different ways to do that, right?
Yeah. Laparoscopic surgery is the most common.
Right.
That's where they make a few small incisions and use tiny instruments to remove it.
That sounds a lot less invasive than open surgery.
Oh, yeah. Definitely. It means less scarring and quicker recovery time.
So can you live a normal life without a gallbladder?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay, good.
Your liver kind of takes over and starts delivering the bile straight to your small intestine.
So digestion still happens.
Exactly. Some people might have some bloating or looser stools as their body adjusts.
But overall, it's not usually a major issue.
Yeah, for most people, it's not a big deal.
Okay, good to know.
Yeah.
So let's back up a bit.
Okay.
Since it's an emergency surgery, things probably move pretty quickly.
Yeah, they do. Often it's not much time to prepare.
So what can you do?
Well, it's really important to have a designated healthcare representative.
Someone who can speak for you if you're unable to.
Exactly. Especially if any tough decisions need to be made during the surgery.
Like about medical interventions.
Right. It's crucial to have someone who understands your wishes.
This makes me think of advanced medical directives, too.
Oh, absolutely.
So important to have those in place ahead of time.
It really gives you and your loved ones peace of mind.
For sure.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's say the surgery happens. Everything goes well.
Okay.
What can you expect when you wake up in the hospital?
Well, you'll probably have an IV for fluids and pain meds.
Okay.
And the medical team will be monitoring your vital signs.
To make sure everything's stable.
Exactly.
You might also have a drainage tube.
Yes, near the incision.
Is that normal?
Oh, yeah, totally normal. It just helps prevent fluid buildup.
Okay.
Don't worry, it's only temporary.
And are there any dietary restrictions after surgery?
Yeah, you'll likely start with clear liquids.
Okay.
And then gradually move to more solid foods.
As your system recovers.
Right. The nurses will guide you through that.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
Now, I read about this thing called post-surgical delirium.
Mm-hmm.
What exactly is that?
So it's basically a state of confusion that can happen after surgery.
Like a mental fog?
Yeah, kind of. Yeah. It usually happens in older adults.
What are the symptoms?
Things like disorientation, memory problems, even hallucinations sometimes.
Oh, wow.
But it's usually temporary. It resolves as you recover.
Okay.
But it's important to be aware of it.
And let the nurses know if you notice anything unusual.
Exactly.
Okay, what about pain management after surgery?
Well, there's a big push towards using non-opioid options now.
To avoid side effects.
Right, like constipation and drowsiness.
But you might still need opioids depending on your pain.
Yes, it really depends on your individual needs.
The important thing is to communicate with your care team.
Absolutely. Let them know your pain level so they can adjust your meds accordingly.
So what are some of the reasons you might have a longer stay in the hospital?
Well, things like nausea and vomiting can delay recovery.
Okay.
And any signs of infection at the incision site?
Makes sense.
Sometimes there might be unexpected complications during surgery.
That require more treatment.
Right.
So it's good to be prepared for those possibilities.
Definitely.
So speaking of being prepared, let's talk about what happens when you're ready to go home.
Yeah.
What are some of the criteria you need to meet before you can be discharged?
Well, your pain needs to be managed.
Okay.
You should be able to get out of bed and move around safely.
And tolerate a basic diet.
Right. And of course, your wound needs to be healing well.
So you get a lot of information at discharge, right?
Absolutely.
What are some of the most important things to pay attention to?
You'll get instructions on medications, wound care.
Prescriptions.
Yeah. And they'll schedule a follow-up appointment.
Usually within a couple of weeks.
Right, something like that.
So what are some good questions to ask before you leave?
Don't be shy. Anything that's on your mind.
It's your recovery.
Exactly.
So ask about specific activities.
When can you drive, shower, go back to work or school?
That kind of thing.
Yeah, and ask about what kind of physical activity is safe.
And any restrictions?
And what to watch for in terms of complications.
Who to call if you have any problems.
Exactly.
Okay, so now you're home, you've got your instructions, starting to feel a bit more like yourself.
Right.
What are some key things you can do to ensure a smooth recovery?
Well, one of the most important is to follow your doctor's instructions.
Yeah, that seems obvious, but...
It is, but it's easy to get ahead of yourself, you know?
Especially when you start feeling better.
Exactly. You want to jump back into things, but it's so important to listen to your body.
And give yourself time to heal.
Yeah, it's not a race.
So let's talk specifics.
Okay.
What about wound care? How do you take care of that incision at home?
So keeping it clean and dry is key.
Like I remember reading in the material.
Right. Gently wash it with soap and water every day.
Okay.
Pat it dry. Don't rub.
And don't use any hard soaps or lotions.
No, those can irritate the skin.
What about those adhesives?
Oh, yeah, don't pick at those.
Let them fall off naturally.
Exactly.
Okay, so when can you shower?
That's a good question, and it really depends.
On what?
On the type of incision you have and what your doctor says.
So you might need to stick with sponge baths for a bit.
You might, for a few days.
Or maybe shower with precautions?
Yeah, like avoiding direct water on the incision.
Okay, so definitely ask for specific instructions before you leave the hospital.
For sure.
What about driving? When is it safe to drive again?
Another good question. Again, it really depends.
This time on?
On the pain meds you're on and how quickly your reflexes come back.
So better to wait a while.
Yeah, probably at least a week or two.
But talk to your doctor. So you're home, you're taking care of the incision, you're moving around a little.
Okay.
What about exercise?
Oh, walking is great.
Yeah.
Start with short walks around the house.
And gradually increase the distance.
Exactly, as you feel stronger.
And are there any movements or activities you should avoid?
Yes. Definitely avoid heavy lifting.
Or anything too strenuous.
Right, nothing that strains your abs for a few weeks.
So no sit-ups?
No, not yet.
What about lifting? Are there weight restrictions?
Oh, yeah. Your doctor will give you specifics.
And no contact sports.
Right. Anything with a risk of falls or impact to the abdomen is a no-go.
So you're moving, getting some fresh air.
Oh, okay.
Now let's talk about food.
Okay.
You need dietary tips.
So protein is super important.
I remember that from the material.
It helps your body repair and rebuild.
Especially after surgery.
Right. So go for lean proteins.
Like what?
Chicken, fish, beans, lentils, tofu.
Greek yogurt.
Yeah, lots of options.
And what if you can't eat big meals?
Try smaller, more frequent meals throughout the day.
That's a good strategy.
Yeah.
Are there any foods to avoid?
Generally, greasy, fatty, fried foods are a no-no.
Okay.
They can be hard to digest.
Might cause some discomfort.
Right. So pay attention to how your body reacts.
And if you're having bloating or gas
or diarrhea,
try cutting out certain foods.
Exactly.
It's all about listening to your body.
It really is.
So what about weight? Is it normal to fluctuate after surgery?
Some weight loss is totally normal.
Especially at the beginning.
Right. Could be fluid shifts from the surgery.
Okay.
Or changes in your diet.
But if you notice a lot of weight loss.
Or if it doesn't stabilize.
Talk to your doctor.
Yes. Make sure there's no underlying issue.
Now I want to shift gears a little.
Okay.
And talk about the emotion side of recovery.
Yeah.
It's not always talked about, but it's important.
It really is.
So let's dive into that a bit.
Okay.
So you're dealing with the physical recovery, the changes in your diet.
Maybe some discomfort.
It can all take a toll.
Absolutely. It's a lot to handle. Yeah.
So what are some ways to cope with those emotional challenges?
Well, first of all, don't isolate yourself.
Yeah, it's easy to withdraw when you're not feeling great.
Right. But staying connected is so important.
Talk to friends and family.
Let them know how you're feeling.
And how they can help.
Exactly.
What about professional help? Is that something to consider?
Oh, absolutely. If you're feeling overwhelmed or anxious.
Or depressed.
Don't hesitate to reach out to a therapist.
They can give you tools to cope.
And remember, you're not alone.
There are resources out there.
And seeking help is a sign of strength.
I want to circle back to something you mentioned before.
Okay.
About having a healthcare representative and advanced medical directives.
Uh-huh.
Those conversations can be tough.
They can, but they're so crucial.
Imagine having to make those decisions in an emergency.
It adds so much stress.
So having those conversations ahead of time.
It's a gift to yourself and your loved ones.
And speaking of gifts, Those checklists and planners you provided for our listener, those are like practical gifts.
They are. They can really help stay organized.
Especially when you're feeling overwhelmed.
Yeah, or forgetful.
So what are some of the key things they cover?
Well, they cover a lot, from managing pain and meds to tracking appointments and diet changes.
Okay.
Like the medication checklist helps you keep track of what you're taking and when.
When to take them. Any side effects?
Right. Especially helpful when you're still foggy from anesthesia.
And what about the pain management tracker?
That one lets you track your pain levels throughout the day.
And what's causing the discomfort.
Right. So you can talk to your doctor about adjusting your meds.
Or exploring other options.
Exactly.
It's like a personalized pain management plan.
It is.
And there's a section for activity levels.
Yeah, that one's all about pacing yourself and gradually increasing activity as you heal.
So you can note your daily walks, exercises, any restrictions.
Right. It helps you stay accountable.
Now I want to talk about preparing your home for recovery.
Oh, good one. That's often overlooked.
But it can make a huge difference.
It really can.
So what are some practical things people can do?
We'll start by decluttering.
Especially the areas where you'll be spending most of your time.
Right, and remove tripping hazards like rugs or cords.
You want clear paths for walking.
Yes, and make sure essentials are within reach.
Like meds, water bottles, snacks.
Exactly, anything you might need.
What about furniture adjustments?
Oh yeah, a shower chair can be a game changer if you're unsteady.
A raised toilet seat too.
Right, makes it easier to get up and down.
And a comfortable chair to relax in.
With armrests.
Maybe a bedside table for your essentials.
Yeah, those are all good ideas.
It's about making your home comfortable and supportive for healing.
Exactly.
Don't forget about food prep.
Oh, that's important.
Stock up on easy-to-prepare meals and snacks before surgery.
Soups, smoothies, yogurt, pre-cut fruits and veggies.
Easy stuff.
Right.
And what about clothes? What's comfortable to wear during recovery?
Loose-fitting clothes are the way to go.
Like pajamas and sweatpants.
Yep. Loose shirts, comfortable underwear.
Anything that won't irritate the incision.
Right. Soft, breathable fabrics.
Comfort is key.
It really is.
So preparing your home is just as important as preparing yourself.
I agree.
Now, you mentioned managing urinary changes after surgery.
Oh, yeah. That can be a thing.
Why does that happen?
It's usually because of the anesthesia and meds.
Yeah.
It's usually temporary. But if you have pain or burning.
Or if it gets worse.
Definitely let your doctor know.
Better to be safe.
Absolutely.
And what about those first few days when you're a little unsteady on your feet?
Oh, yeah.
You mentioned call, don't fall.
Such an important reminder.
So don't be afraid to ask for help getting out of bed or moving around.
Especially in those first few days.
And even at home.
Yes. Especially if you live alone.
Let people know you might need an extra hand.
It's all about safety.
And asking for help is not weakness.
No, not at all. It's self-care.
Now let's talk about intimacy and sexual activity.
Ah, yes, a sensitive topic.
But people want to know when it's safe to resume those activities.
Of course. And like many things, it depends on your individual healing and what your doctor says.
So generally, you should wait until the incision is fully healed.
And you're not in any pain or discomfort.
What about advice for talking to your partner about it?
Open communication is key.
Tell them how you're feeling, physically and emotionally.
Let them know your limits, what you're comfortable with.
Be honest with each other.
Exactly. Find ways to be intimate that work for both of you.
And there's no rush.
None at all.
Now let's talk about follow-up appointments.
Okay.
What can people expect at those?
Usually you'll see your surgeon within a couple of weeks.
Okay.
They'll check your incision, make sure everything's healing well.
Answer any questions you have.
Right. Tell them about any concerns or challenges you're having.
Whether it's about pain, digestion, emotional well-being.
It's like a progress check.
Makes sense.
And don't be afraid to advocate for yourself.
If you're not feeling heard, or if you're still worried,
speak up.
Your healthcare team is there to support you.
They are.
So be an active participant in your recovery.
Exactly.
Now, one last thing I wanted to touch on.
Okay.
Finding support during recovery.
So important.
You don't have to go through this alone.
There are so many resources out there.
Can you give us some examples?
Sure. Online support groups and forums can be great.
Places to share experiences, ask questions.
Get advice from others who've been there.
Organizations with resources specifically for gallbladder surgery recovery.
And don't forget about your own network.
Friends, family, colleagues.
People who've had similar experiences.
Build that support system.
It makes a world of difference.
And don't be afraid to ask for help.
Whether it's with meals, transportation, or just someone to listen.
People want to help.
They do.
So that brings us to the end of this part of our deep dive.
Okay.
We'll wrap up with some key takeaways and final thoughts in our last part. Okay, So we've covered a ton of information here about recovering from emergency gallbladder surgery.
Yeah.
What are some of the most important things for our listener to remember?
You know, I think the biggest thing is to remember that you're not alone in this.
It can feel isolating, especially when it's an emergency situation.
It really can.
But there's a whole community of people who've been through the same thing.
And so many resources out there to help.
And speaking of resources, those checklists and planners you made.
Yeah.
Those are like packed with tips and reminders.
I tried to make them super practical and easy to use.
Especially because you might not be feeling your best after surgery.
Right. You might be a little foggy.
So use them as your guide.
Refer back to them as much as you need to.
And don't be afraid to ask your healthcare team any questions.
They're there to help.
We talked earlier about advocating for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
What does that actually look like during recovery?
It means speaking up if something's not right.
Like if the pain isn't being managed well.
Or if you're having trouble sleeping.
Or if you're feeling anxious or overwhelmed.
Don't keep it to yourself. Tell your doctor or nurses.
They need to know what's going on in order to help.
Exactly. It's a partnership.
You and your healthcare team working together.
To get you back on your feet.
You're the expert on your own body.
That's right.
So don't downplay your symptoms or ignore how you're feeling.
Be open and honest so they can provide the best care.
Now let's talk about the emotional side of things again.
Okay.
It's easy to focus on the physical recovery.
But the emotional part is just as important.
It's normal to feel all sorts of emotions.
Relief, frustration, anxiety.
Maybe even some grief.
It's a big adjustment.
So don't judge yourself for feeling those things.
Give yourself time to process them.
And reach out for support if you need it.
Talking to someone can really help.
So how can our listener take care of their emotional well-being during recovery?
Well, self-care is huge.
What does that look like?
Get enough rest. Eat healthy foods.
Do things you enjoy.
Even simple things. Reading. Listening to music. Being in nature.
And connection is so important.
Talk to loved ones. Join a support group. Maybe see a therapist.
It's about remembering you're not alone.
And it's okay to ask for help.
One last thing I want to emphasize. Be patient with yourself.
Yes, so important.
Recovery takes time, and everyone heals at their own pace.
Don't compare yourself to others.
Celebrate your progress.
Even the small victories.
Focus on moving forward.
One step at a time.
And that brings us to the end of our deep dive on emergency gallbladder surgery recovery.
It's been a pleasure.
We hope this is giving you the information and support you need.
Remember, you've got this.
And to our listener, we wish you a smooth and speedy recovery.